So up till now we have covered the free vibration response of a single degree of freedom system. We have derived that expression, and I hope that using that expression, if you are given with some example single degree of freedom system with some m value, with some k value, and with some c value, you should be able to calculate the response, the free vibration response. You should be able to plot that. You should be able to calculate the time period and omega for that. In the second lecture, we discussed about the harmonic loading, that if this single degree of freedom system is subjected to a force P of T, which is sinusoidal in its nature, how you should be able to calculate that U of T for that. Basically, the UP of T, which is the particular part of the solution. But you know already that the complete solution contains another part which is homogeneous and which has a decay function. So we sometimes neglect it if the applied loading sustains for a sufficiently long time. Now we were discussing the periodic loading discussion, and that was if the applied loading is represented by a periodic function, and the definition of periodic function is that it repeats its value after a particular fixed time, capital T, which is the time period of that periodic function. So now our P of T is a periodic function, and definition is that it its value at any time instant T and T plus capital T are exactly same. So the pattern is repeating itself after every T seconds, where capital T is the time period of that periodic function. So many real loadings, although it still is very far from a random loading, which is ideally supposed to be caused by a ground shaking or any random loading phenomena like wind loading, but some of the simpler dynamic loadings may be assumed to have this kind of a pattern. For example, wave loading on offshore structures, or wind forces induced by vortex shedding on taller cylinder structures, they can be represented approximately by a periodic function. It can have any shape, but that shape should repeat itself after every T seconds, which where T is the time period. So I hope that now you are familiar with the idea of Fourier series, and that is that any periodic function can be expanded like this, shown by the equation 1, that any function P of T, if it is periodic, it can be represented by this series, where a series have the first constant term A naught, then An cos n omega bar T plus Bn sin n omega bar T, and n will keep on repeating forever, and therefore we have two summation terms in that. So this is a series itself having all the cos terms of the expansion, and this series is having the sine terms of that expansion. So basically it's like this, that A naught plus A1 cos 1 omega bar T plus A2 cos 2 omega bar T plus, this will be continuing, and then again plus sine terms will also be added to the same series. So it will be B1 sine 1 times omega bar T plus B2 sine 2 times omega bar T plus, it will be continued forever up to n equal to infinity. So the idea is that although you may not be able to actually you may not be able to actually calculate all the terms in this expansion, but as you keep on increasing more and more terms on the right hand side, the shape of the total summation, total right hand side, will keep on approaching more and more close to the actual P of T. And one of the demonstrations which we have saw in case of the scalar function, which was like this. So I show you in next slides that as we keep on increasing more and more terms on the right hand side, and you sum them and then you plot the sum, that sum will keep on looking more and more close to that you can say the actual periodic function, which was scalar function. So this equation 1 is basically the Fourier series, Fourier expansion, Fourier decomposition. There are different names for that, but the idea is that any periodic function can be expanded into harmonic components. See, each of these terms, either it is cos or sine, it is a harmonic component. Some constant multiplied by the cos function or some constant multiplied by the sine function. So all of these constants are unknown, but sine and cos functions, they tell us that the variation of that individual function will be sinusoidal. Cos function is also harmonic because its variation is same as sine function with a 90 degree phase difference. So which means all of these terms are harmonics. So as we keep on adding more and more harmonics, the total sum keeps on approaching to the actual P of T. So the idea was from obviously from Fourier, and we can also calculate the coefficients of this Fourier series A naught, which is the constant coefficient in the Fourier series, and then all the A, N and B, N. So all of these coefficients, because all we need to know are these coefficients A naught, A1, A2, A3, up to whatever we want, and then B1, B2, B3, up to whatever we want. So in fact, we have to calculate all of these coefficients in order to have that expansion for any given function. So we know already, I mean, if you go through standard mathematics textbooks about Fourier expansion, you can easily derive these expressions where you have to calculate A naught or A1, A2, A3, etc., or B1, B2, B3, etc. One example which I can give is from the same reference textbook which I mentioned last time also, and that is the Erwin Krasick textbook. And I think I have that opened already here, so let me show you. The chapter 11 of that book deals with the Fourier analysis, and it starts with the basic discussion about Fourier series. It defines the periodic function, and then it states the Fourier series, which is this equation 5. This is the same equation which I show in the slides also. And then he also shows these three expressions to calculate these coefficients. These coefficients for the Fourier expansion. And these coefficients, these three equations are called Euler formulas. And these Euler equations are derived here after the same basic example which I also included. Here, these Euler formulas are derived, and then you can go through this topic, and finally you come up with the same three expressions to calculate these coefficients. So I may not be able to go to all of that detail, so I assume that you already will consult that reference if you are not familiar with the coefficients of Fourier expansion. The summary is that this A naught, the constant term in the Fourier expansion, is equal to 1 over capital T, which is the time period, and it is the integration of the actual P of T, which is the actual periodic function. And AM or BM, they basically are equal to these terms. Here, for AM, P of T is multiplied with cos m omega bar T. M will be from 1 to any number. And then their integration, and you have 2 over capital T. For BM, you have, instead of cos, you have sin m omega bar T. So these equations 1, 2 and 3, these three equations are the ones which will be used to calculate the Fourier expansion coefficients. So A naught is equal to 1 over T integration from t 0 to capital T p of t dt. So in order to evaluate these three equation 2, in order to evaluate these three equations 2, 3 and 4, you might have guessed already that you have to actually have the equation of the periodic function. So what we do is that we describe a periodic function with a piecewise function. So p of t is not one equation, it is basically a set of maybe three equations for three different ranges of you can say x values. For example, if you have a scalar function like this, so you will say that from this time to this time the value of periodic function is a constant value, let's call it a or k, maybe any constant, and then from this time to that next time the value becomes minus k suddenly. So you describe basically the actual periodic function with a piecewise function. So similarly, the integration also basically expand into different ranges of t equal to 0 to capital T. For example, we know already the capital T for this scalar function is this time. So the small t, which is the variable t, is divided into two parts. The first part in which the function value is positive k, and the second part in which the function value is negative k. So the integration also will be divided into two parts. In first part the value of function will be positive k, and in the second part it will be minus k. So you have to first define the periodic function in different ranges of time, from 0 to capital T, which is the time period, and then use that here in equation 2, 3 and 4, and then solve that integration to come up with the coefficients of Fourier expansion. So I assume that you have tried the Fourier expansions of some basic simple kind of functions. So this one we saw that already last lecture, that now this is a piecewise function which describes a Fourier expansion. So you already have positive k from 0 to pi, and from pi to 2 pi the value of the function suddenly becomes minus k. So it's a constant function basically which fluctuates between positive k and minus k suddenly at a certain point, and it keeps on repeating, and it has a time period equal to 2 pi. So now we can calculate a naught, we can calculate a1, a2, a3 up to certain number of harmonics which we want, and b1, b2, b3 also we can calculate by using that three equations which I showed in last slide. So let's quickly solve them. A naught basically equal to 1 over capital T integration of p of t dt. So, and this t is 0 to capital T basically. This was our definition. So we know already that the integration of p of t from 0 to capital T, basically it is the area under the curve or area under that original function from 0 to capital T, and 0 to capital T is this one, I mean from here, and this one area also, and we know that the sum of that area is 0. So we know even graphically that this a naught equal to 0 in this specific case. Otherwise we could have calculated that also, a naught is equal to 1 over 2 pi, because 2 pi is the time period, 0 to 2 pi, and because we have you know basically p of t here dt. The issue is that now from 0 to 2 pi the function is changing its value. So we can also expand the integral like 1 over 2 pi, in bracket we have integration from 0 to pi, the value of the function p of t is k dt, plus from pi to 2 pi the value of the function is minus k dt, and 1 over 2 pi is being multiplied with the whole expression. So here, from here you can solve 1 over 2 pi. In bracket you have kt from 0 to pi plus, in fact, minus kt, basically you can say this also from 0 to pi. So this will obviously cancel each other even if you put that t limits, but it is obvious that this will cancel. So you will get a not equal to 0. So that's how you use that expression to calculate a not equal to 0. Similarly, you can also use the next expression to calculate a1, a2, a3, and you will observe that all of the a coefficients will also be 0. And by the way, I can just quickly write it here. An is basically 2 over capital T. Let me go back and check. It is 2 over capital T, T 0 to capital T, P of T cos m omega bar T, m or n, whatever you want to use that symbol. So P of T is being multiplied by cos n omega bar T. So let's keep that subscript equal to n, and here also we will have n dt, and T will be equal to 0 to capital T. So all we can do is that we can just put that expression 2 over 2 pi, because capital T is 2 pi here, and in bracket again we can just split that integration into two parts. So one will be from 0 to pi, and then the value of the function is k cos n omega bar t dt, plus the second integral will be from pi to 2 pi minus k cos n omega bar t dt. Here again you can easily see that even with the visual observation, you can easily observe that the function will be, sorry, here from here the limit should be from pi to 2 pi. Pi to 2 pi. Sorry, this was my mistake, so please correct that. In the second integral, it is from pi to 2 pi. So it means that it will not simply cancel out, we have to solve it. So for that, we can put pi k, here is pi k, and it will be minus it will be minus 2 pi k minus pi k. It will be this one, and then you will have pi k minus 2 pi k plus pi k. So now it will be cancelled out and a naught will be 0. So it will not be simply cancelled out, but when you put that limit, and then it will be cancelled out. So similarly here also, when you put the limits and solve that integral, you will get 0. So that's why since we didn't put n value equal to 1, 2 or 3, we just keep it as n, and we solve it for a n, and it turned out to be 0, which means for all values of n, all the a coefficients will be 0. So I just write here a n equal to 0, okay, and a naught also equal to 0. Now similarly you can apply the second expression, about third expression basically, about b n, and that was 2 over capital T, T equal to 0 to T equal to capital T, P of T sine n omega bar T dt. So you can solve that expression, you can expand that integral into two parts from 0 to pi and pi to 2 pi, and put the value of P of T for both of the ranges, and then put solve that integral, put the limit, you will get Bn equal to this whole term. So now, now we are in a position to calculate all the coefficients required for the Fourier expansion of that function, and we know already that a naught is 0, all the a terms are 0, and the expansion only contains all the b terms. So you can put n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. to calculate all the b coefficients, maybe up to 10 or 20 functions. And then you can write the Fourier expansion that P of t is equal to a naught is 0, all the cos terms are 0. So we are left with only b1 sine 1 omega bar t, which was basically b1 is this one, so 4k over pi, because we put n equal to 1 in this expression to get b1. B2 is 0 if we put n equal to 2. B3 again this one, b4 is 0. So even in b terms, the alternate coefficients are 0, and the all the odd, basically odd b1, b3, b5 are non-zero. So you will have p of t obviously is, according to Fourier expansion, is a naught plus a1 an summation n equal to 1 to infinity. Sorry, an is here, an cos n omega bar t plus summation n equal to 1 to infinity bn sin n omega bar t. So you know already that this whole term is already 0 because all the an are 0. This term is 0. So you are only left with this summation expansion. And even in that bn, all the even bn are 0. b2, b4, b6 are all 0. Because there is a pattern when you put n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that pattern will continue. And you will only have b1, b3, b5 in this expansion. So you will have 4 pi over t, which is b1 sine n omega bar t, where n is 1 here, so sine omega bar t, plus b2 will be 0, and then b3 will be non-zero. B3 is this one, so you will have 4k over 3 pi sine 3 omega bar t, plus again b5, which is 4k over 5 pi sine 5 omega bar t. So even, and this will continue forever, even these harmonics, individual terms, have a pattern in them. 4k is common, and then one is here is 1k and 1 omega bar. Here is 3, it is pi here, 4k over pi. So here you have 3 pi and 3 omega bar t, 5k, 5 pi and 5 omega bar t. So 4k is common in the numerator, but in the denominator it is 1, 3, 5, pi, etc. And in the angle also obviously it will change. So that's how you have found out the Fourier expansion of one of the functions which was given, which was the scalar function. You can use the same procedure to expand any periodic function if it is described by a piecewise function just like the scalar function. Now the idea is that if you want to calculate the response u of t against this p of t, all you can do is that you can calculate the response against all of these individual harmonics, individual harmonic forces, you can say now, and sum all those responses to get the response against this total p of t. This was the basic idea. So for example, if you want to be more accurate and you know that the first 20 terms of this expansion, if they are added, they will be accurately capturing that shape. So which means that you have to calculate the response for first 20 terms and then sum those 20 responses to get u of t. This idea is called superposition, and it simply states that if you decompose the force and calculate response against each of its component, and you sum those components, you get the same response which you would be getting if the same force is applied simultaneously. I mean the complete force is applied at once. So this is only applicable for linear systems where the order of the application of force doesn't matter. So here now what I'm doing is that S1 means that only one term is considered in the Fourier expansion. S3 means that the first term and the third term, because the second term is already zero. S5 means that first, third and fifth term, if we put the values b1, b3, b5 and sum them, you get S5. So as we are increasing from S1 to S3 to S5, we are kind of started capturing that actual shape. So if we go to, for example, S50, which means the sum of first 50, you can say b functions or 50 harmonics, then you will almost get exactly the same the same rectangular or kind of square function. One of the important point is that all of the higher harmonics, if I go back and see this Fourier expansion of the square function, here you have a sine function which is having a frequency equal to omega bar. Here you have a sine function which has a frequency equal to 3 omega bar. The third term is a sine function which has a frequency equal to 5 omega bar. So as we are going towards higher harmonics, the frequency of the sine functions are increasing. So if I represent the first sine function with this value, let's say this shape, the second would be maybe like this, and the third would be even having a very high frequency like that. And as we keep on increasing going towards higher harmonics, the term on the denominator keeps on increasing. 1 pi, 3 pi, 5 pi, 7 pi, 9 pi, and the numerator is constant. So which means that the total amplitude of the harmonics, all the harmonics, is keep on reducing. The amplitude is reducing as we go more and more, but the frequency is increasing. So that is evident from these figures also, that S1 contains only one first harmonic. So it is a sine function. Then you have another harmonic, which is the third term, and that third term is this one, sine 3 pi or 3 omega bar t. So now you have a relatively high frequency wave but having a low amplitude. The next term alone will be even high frequency than the first two, but even will be having a low amplitude. So as we are going towards higher harmonics, the frequency is increasing and the amplitude is reducing. So which means that in the amplitude, only the first few harmonics have the significant contribution towards the final amplitude, because the final amplitude is k, because the actual function is fluctuating between k and minus k. So the first few harmonics will have the maximum contribution towards the actual amplitude, which was k. Similarly, the frequency content also, as we keep on increasing going to higher harmonics, the frequency is increasing and its contribution towards the final signal keeps on reducing. So even by adding first 5 or 10 terms in that, you will actually start capturing the shape, the actual shape of the periodic function. And the more and more high terms you add, their effect will keep on kind of accumulating, but the first few will have the most effect. So here you can see S5 is the sum of first 5 terms, S9 is 9 terms, and then here you have S25. So you can see that the actual amplitude was, let's say, k was equal to 10. This is k value 10. So if you sum the first 9 terms, the amplitude is already fluctuating somewhat above and below the 10 value, which is the k value. That fluctuation will keep on reducing, but even if you add 25 terms, that fluctuation will still be there, although with very low amplitude of fluctuation, but it is keep on converging to the 10 value here. So the higher terms will have less and less role as you go more and more harmonics. So the series which we used as an example, it converged quickly to the square function, which was our original P of t, which we have expanded using Fourier's idea. So in many practical applications, it is not necessary to evaluate infinite terms. Only first few harmonics are enough to capture the actual function. So in this specific case, which was a square function, we know already that a naught was 0 and a1 was also 0. So only b terms were there, non-zero terms. So we can simply reduce that Fourier expansion to only bn sine n omega bar t. And also b are calculated and they had a very fixed pattern, bn was like 4k over n pi. So if you have n equal to 3, it will be 3 pi, and then 5 means 5 pi. So bn have a very regular kind of a shape, and sine function can be multiplied and then added to make a series. So the response of a periodic loading is equal to response to the Fourier expansion of that loading. This idea is called superposition. The sum of the responses to each sine and cos loadings in the series, their sum will be equal to the response to the total periodic loading. We can verify that also, obviously, for linear structures. If we have a force applied equal to P1 and the response is U1, this equation will govern. If we apply the force equal to P2 and the response is U2, this will govern that equation. So what we can do is that we can simply you can simply say that U1 plus U2 is basically their sum is equal to the response to the forces P1 plus P2. This can be simply concluded by just adding these two equations. You will get this resultant equation. Obviously, you can rearrange these terms, take m common, and it will become like this. So now that equation is simply telling you on the right hand side, you have an applied force, which is equal to the sum of P1 and P2. And this is the sum U. This is the sum total velocity, the U1 and U2 dot. And this is the total acceleration. So this equation simply tells you that even if you apply P1 and P2 separately, calculate their responses and sum them, you will get the same response. If you directly apply P1 plus P2, the same response you will get as a result. So sometimes I call it that superposition also means that the order of the application of force doesn't matter. I mean, and it is applicable only to the linear systems which follow F is equal to KU, for example. So you have, for example, U and F, and the system is linear, which means that the relation between F and U will always be linear forever. So if you apply some force up to this point and you get a response up to this level, and from there you apply another force up to that point and you reach to that point. So obviously this displacement, let's say this is U1, this is U2, this is F1, this is F2. So obviously, since the structure have to follow the straight line forever, which means that even if you apply F1 plus F2 straight away, suddenly in one instant, the structure will simply reach to U1 plus U2 at the same time instant. So the order of the application of force also doesn't matter. Even if you apply F2 first and then F1 later, finally you will get to the same displacement, which was the total U2 displacement, which was this one. But just imagine that your structure was not linear. Just imagine that the relationship between U and F is not straight line, it is a curved line, for example, like this. In that case, this superposition was not valid, because let's say F1 is a smaller force and F2 is a larger force. So you apply a smaller force first or larger force first doesn't matter in case of a linear system, because ultimately you will reach to the same U value, because the governing equation is F is equal to KU. So even if you apply small force, you will get small displacement first. Then later you add more force, you will have more displacement. Ultimately, you reach to the same point. But for nonlinear system, F is not equal to KU. So F is not equal to KU. So it is a nonlinear system, and the relationship between F and U is a nonlinear line. In that case, the order of the application of force matters. The superposition doesn't hold. For example, here, if you add first small force, which reach your structure to this point, which basically deforms your structure to that particular point, and then you apply the larger force later, ultimately, let's say you reach to this point. Now reverse that application and apply the larger force first. Even the larger force will just yield your structure in just one go. And then even a smaller force after yield will produce a large deformation. So ultimately you will not reach to the same point if you apply these two forces in opposite orders. First F1 and then F2, or first F2 and then F1. Because the structure may yield under the first force, so the second force will produce more deformation compared to what was predicted by F is equal to Ku, because the structure has already yielded. So that's why this idea is not valid for nonlinear systems. In fact, all of the classical solution which we are studying, for example, harmonic, periodic, or even other which we will be studying later, they are strictly applicable only to linear systems which are like this. For nonlinear systems, we have a separate category of solutions, and that also we will study in one lectures, maybe from next to next lecture. So let's see the response of each term of the Fourier expansion. The first term in the Fourier expansion is a constant number, a naught, a constant force in this case, because if P of t is a force, each term of this expansion is a force. The first term is a constant force, which is a static force. So the response against static force is clear. That is simply force divided by K, and you will get the response against the first static force. So U naught A is basically the response against A naught force. Now let's assume, let's first take the case for this one term in this expansion, sine term. So any general term will be basically Bn sine n omega bar t, and n will be 1, 2, 3, 4 up to infinity. Let's call the response against this general term as UBn, which is this one, UBn function of time. Obviously, we know that this is a harmonic loading, and harmonic loading, we know already the response. That response we have already, and it had two equations which we derived. One was a shorter form of that equation. You remember that rho p sine omega bar t minus theta p. That was a shorter form of that equation. But there was a longer form of that equation also, and that was some p naught over k, 1 over this whole thing, if you just see the form of that equation, some a sine theta minus b cos theta, and then we condense that equation into this short form. So let's use that long form of that equation to calculate or to demonstrate the response against this general, this is a kind of a generalized periodic loading, or sorry, harmonic loading with sine function, with one or two differences. First difference is that P naught is basically Bn here, P naught, because that is the constant multiplied by the sine function. The second difference is that now you have the frequency n omega bar instead of only omega bar. We have calculated a kind of a response against this kind of loading, P naught sine omega bar t. But now our loading is of this form, that we have Bn sine n omega bar t. So which means if we replace these two things in our solution, we will get this UBn, the same solution which we have derived in last lecture. So P naught can be replaced by Bn everywhere, wherever it appeared in the solution. The second thing is this n omega bar. We have derived the frequency ratio as beta in last lecture, and that was omega bar over omega. Omega bar was defined as the frequency of the applied loading. Now we know that the frequency of the applied loading is n omega bar, and it n will be varying basically. N will be 1, and you will get 1 beta, and then the next term you will have another sine function with another applied loading frequency, because n will be multiplied with omega bar. So let's define beta n equal to n times omega bar over omega. So automatically for n equal to 1, our beta 1 will be simply omega bar over omega, But for n equal to 2, we will have another beta 2, which will be 2 times omega bar over omega. So everywhere we know that since n is multiplied with the omega bar in our sine function, applied loading sine function, it will be appearing the same as n omega bar everywhere in the response also. So let's replace beta with beta n, where beta n is n times omega bar over omega. And let's replace bn with p naught, basically p naught with bn. And then use the same expression which we have derived in last lecture, p naught over k, which means bn over k, 1 over 1 minus beta square will become now n beta n square plus 2 xi beta n square. Inside the bracket you will have 1 minus beta n square sine function. Now sine will have n omega bar in its angle, not only omega bar, and 2 xi beta n cos n omega bar t. So this is the response, or theoretical response you can say, against any nth harmonic. So let me write it as response under an nth harmonic. So this is only the response. You replace n with 1, 2, 3, 4. You will keep on getting responses for different harmonics. But this is only for sine function, one term or general term in this sine expansion. Similarly, you also have this cos expansion. But you know already that the same equation will have the response, will demonstrate the response for cos function also. The difference will be that these coefficients of cos and sine will be replaced with each other. So any UAN, which means the response against any harmonic which is the expansion in cos term, you will get that here, the same equation which is the last equation, last slide, but this 2 xi beta n is replaced, it becomes now sine coefficient, and 1 minus beta square is now with cos. With that difference, and obviously the p naught will be now an and not bn, so you will also be getting all the responses of the cos expansions of that Fourier expansion. So now you also already know u a naught, u naught a is basically simply a naught over k, that is a constant force and constant response, but the other two terms will have UBN and UAN. So now if you have, for example, a function p of t which is equal to some a naught plus 20 terms in cos plus 20 terms in sine, you have to apply the same equation kind of 20 times for UBN and 20 times for UAN, and you sum the responses to get the response against total p of t. But I don't think that you have to do it for all 20 times. Mostly for first few harmonics, the response already converges to the response against total periodic load. Just like the shape of the total sum of Fourier expansion converges to the shape of the actual periodic function. The same equation for harmonic, you can say, response is used now again and again for different n values to get the response against each harmonic of the periodic expansion. You have to plot those sum to get that idea that how much harmonic, how much number of harmonics you require. But only first few, 3, 4, 5 harmonics, it depends on how much accuracy you want. For example, I say that, 5% or let's say 10% inaccuracy between the total sum of harmonics and the actual p of t is allowed.
Okay.
That 10% accuracy, that 10% error or inaccuracy, that tolerance if you have, only first 5 or 6 harmonics were enough. You can see here in the example which we did. Here, already by adding first S9, you know S9 means that you just added how many terms? Because S5
terms.
Means only 3 terms.
Five terms, yes, sir.
S7 will have 4 terms and S9 will have 5 terms. So by just adding 5 terms or 5 first 5 harmonics, you reached already to a very close shape to the actual square periodic function. So I think no need to go to S25 or S50. Only first 5-6 terms are enough if you have an accuracy. So obviously this, if this is 10, then this may be 11 or 12. So already you are in that tolerance which you set for yourself. Obviously. So very few terms are required. This is basically the beauty of this idea, that you don't need to go to infinite terms or very large number of terms. So now let's also write the total response u of t corresponding to the actual p of t in terms of that same equation which we have derived. So what I did here is 1 over k is basically a naught over k, because 1 over k was constant in all of these three terms. You see here, 1 over k is here, 1 over k is here, and 1 over k is here. So when we add these three things to get the total u, 1 over k can be taken constant, and then in the bracket you will have a naught, in fact it should be a naught like this, plus this whole summation. Obviously in that also cos and sine, what I did is I combined them. So we have basically this whole thing was also common, this was also common in both of these equations, so I take that out also. So that is also out from that bracket, and inside that you will have this four terms now. So with this expression, I mean this is just a generalized expression, if all of the a naught and a1, a2, a3 and b are given, b1, b2, b3, etc. Basically you just only need first few, maybe a naught, a1, a2 and b1, b2. And most of the times some functions have all the a terms equal to 0 and only b terms are all non-zero. Sometimes only b are all 0 and a are you can say non-zero. So I have shown you the Fourier expansion of some basic periodic functions in the appendix of that presentation, and you might have seen that some expansions have only cos terms, some have only sine terms, and some complex functions have both cos and sine terms. So now any given applied loading periodic function can be solved now. Only the complexity is increased, the computation is increased now because you have more and more terms, but they all are governed, or basically the response is calculated using the same expression which we have derived for harmonic case. So let's say that you have to calculate a response of a single degree of freedom system for omega equal to 5 radian per second. So the omega is the natural frequency of the structure itself. And let's say that you have a periodic loading which looks like this. This is the loading. So this is the input basically. So let's say that omega bar is equal to 1 and omega is equal to 5. So now you know already that, okay, you can do it now because that you can expand that function to calculate all the harmonics, and then you can calculate the response for each harmonic and then sum them. You can do all that process, but just one insight you should consider, that if the applied loading has a frequency equal to 1 radian per second and your structure have a frequency equal to 5 radian per second, if it was a harmonic, then omega bar was just one fixed number, 1 radian per second. So it was confirmed that your structure will not undergo resonance because there is a significant difference between omega bar and omega. In fact, beta value for that case was 1 over 5 omega bar over omega, which was 0.2, and which means that you are almost in the pseudostatic range. Now, since the applied loading is not harmonic now, in fact this omega bar is the time period of the periodic function and not the harmonic function. So periodic function can be expanded using Fourier series, and each of the term will have its own omega bar. So it is verily possible that if you take first five harmonics in that expansion, any one of them will have a frequency which will match with the natural frequency of the structure. So that particular harmonic will cause resonance. So I hope that you are getting the point that we will have beta n in the general solution, and that was n times omega bar over omega. Because why n times omega bar? Because each harmonic will have this frequency n omega bar. This is the frequency of each term of the Fourier expansion or each harmonic. So which means that if n omega bar matches with omega, beta n becomes 1, that particular harmonic will have resonance with your structure. In this case, beta 1 will be okay 0.2, beta 3 will be 3 times omega bar over omega, which is 0.6, but beta 5 will be 5 times omega bar over omega, and that is 1. So which means that the fifth harmonic, or that term which will have frequency as 5 omega bar, that particular harmonic function or term in the Fourier expansion will result in the resonance with the structure. So the response, the total response, obviously the resonance will have far more response compared to the other harmonics. So the total response will be only dominated by that particular harmonic which will cause resonance. So obviously if the peak value of response caused by first four harmonics is, let's say, some number, let's say 10, that particular fifth harmonic may cause the response equal to 100, maybe 10 times more than the normal response, normal dynamic response. So the total response will be dominated by that particular response against that particular resonant causing harmonic. So in some practical cases, we don't even calculate the response for all other harmonics. We directly go to the one which cause resonance, and that response, that particular harmonic, is the most, you can say, dangerous harmonic for that structure. So the actual time period of that triangular loading may not match with the time period of the structure, but one of its harmonics can match with the time period of the structure, the time period of one of the harmonics.